What's up, April?
My name is Kristopher Edward Ritter. My nickname is Chip. Most of my friends call me Chip, but then again, some friends call me Chris. I've been clean and sober for, I'm well into my 27th year of recovery. From a very early age, I remember having a tough time dealing with life. When I was about 8, a lot of things happened. 8, 9, a lot of things went down in my life that I found hard to understand. I was born left-handed. I always pick stuff up with my left hand, and my mom would always kind of like smack it and put the stuff in my right hand. And she was left-handed and believed back then or whatever that the left-handed person would have more of a struggle and it would be easier for me to do with my right. It kind of made me learn how to write with my right hand, and my writing is all jacked up. And since then, I've kind of been working on making amends to my left side. But what I'm trying to say is I always felt different. I felt like the train with the square wheels, like I was on an island. My best friend was a plane who thought it was a fish, you know what I mean? And I just never fit in. I remember the first time I got alcohol in my system, it took all my fear away, and it was like magic. When I felt drunk or just a little buzzed or whatever, the whole world changed, and I can't even begin to describe what drinking did for me in the beginning. It really took a lot of pain away from me, and I rested in it. And I believe at times in my life, drinking and using drugs, I kind of used to maybe keep myself alive and medicate myself in different ways. And my life was a big party. You know, pretty soon I was drinking more and more, and everything was great. I looked up to my brother, and he drank in high school. God, I wanted to be like Ken, you know? His number was 52. And to this day, it's like, that's his number. You know, when I see a 52, I'll send it to him. Once I had that, you know, once I had the booze going, things were partying, I felt amazing. I ran with that, you know, because my whole life I had spent feeling less than everybody else around me, you know. And when I had the booze in me, things were partying, we would go to keggers and, you know, people would black out and it'd be like a funny story. It would just be like, you know, that's kind of cool, you know. Dude, he drank so much that he blacked out. Whoa, he's a rocker. And I remember partying a lot in Tucson. People that have passed away. People that are no longer with us because of drugs and alcohol. And anyway, it really made me feel alive. I was 10 feet tall and bulletproof, and I could do anything and talk to anybody. Had lots of confidence. Things seemed great, you know. I went, my parents, I was doing bad in high school. I kind of had some problems drinking alcohol, bringing it to school. And I wanted to be like Tommy Lee so bad in high school that I used to practice, you know, grabbing my crotch and spitting on the mirror in the drum room. And my friends would be like, Neil Peart is amazing. And I'd be like, oh yeah, well, Tommy can drink him under the table. You know, I really looked up to that. I wanted to be Tommy. Drinking kind of took over later in life as I went to Altaloma High School in California. I started finding more and more drugs and drinking and using drugs, and it kind of took over. It became more of a necessity. I would wake up in more pain and my life got worse and I had less friends, and it just started taking a toll on me. I remember the times where it started to become out of hand and my life got worse and worse and worse, and I ended up getting a DUI. I played my drums less and less. And the drums weren't that much of a priority. My mini truck was, with the dump bed and the stereo. And I used to watch TV and there'd be a music video on. And I remember being at my house in Altaloma with some friends of mine getting high. And I remember looking at the TV while these big rock show drummers doing this big concert. And I remember going, man, I could do that. And my friends were like, yeah, dude, you could do that. And I'd be like, and nothing ever happened. My life kept getting worse. I had fewer friends to drink with. My brother came to visit me, and it was really important to me to show Ken, because I looked up to him. He's still my hero. It was really important to me when Ken came to visit to keep my stuff together and not to drink, or at least to limit it to one beer. And I had tried for what seemed to be like 2 years or whatever to just have one beer after I finally realized I was in trouble and it had gone out of hand and there's nothing I could do about it to stop it. I had gotten to the point where I kind of resigned myself to, like, I'm gonna die and, oh, what's the point, and, you know, all that stuff. And then finally I started, like, really trying to get sober, and I couldn't. And it was a terrifying place to be. My brother came out, and I really wanted to show him that I had my stuff together. And we took me out to a club, and he's like, yeah, you want a beer? And I was like, yeah, sure. Okay. I'm 20, but okay, let's get a beer. And, of course, I picked the 32-ounce beer on the menu, the biggest one they had. And we sat and talked and caught up a little bit. He had just moved to Florida. And, the beer was gone. And then he looked at me, he's like, you want another beer? And I was like, absolutely. Even though that whole time, during the whole conversation, I was thinking, this is it. I got it. Just one beer. Just one. It's just going to be one. I can totally do this. Just one. I could quit anytime, but I don't feel like it. And just, you know, one. Tonight, one. And when he asked me for another beer, just like, boom, sure. Absolutely. What I'm trying to say is I had no choice. I could not say no. I was powerless. And I went and proceeded to drink and black out that night. I don't remember what else happened or how I got home. I got up and went outside one more time to look at the car. I mean, at that time it was like a truck. To look at the truck and check for dents or blood or hair or whatever, figuring out how I got back. I think my brother drove me that time, but I remember waking up in the morning with this incomprehensible demoralization. This feeling that I had just failed so bad in my whole life that I couldn't even show my brother that I could drink one beer, that without messing that up. And it was one of the lowest points of my life. And when I finally got sober in recovery with my first friend, a Bill sponsor, Jeff Wilson, he had gone through the first step with me, and he said, I just want you to start off by writing out a paragraph on a piece of paper with a pen, one example in your life where you were truly powerless. And that was my example when my brother came out, because if there was anything in the world that I wanted more on that night, it was to drink one beer, and that's it. And I couldn't do that. My life got even worse. I got another DUI. Got into drugs. Just turned and burned. You know, drugs and alcohol took over my life. It was all about, where can I get the next one? Nobody can understand me. It was like alcohol went from being this great blessing in my life and this great tool that I could cope with reality into this thing that started killing me. It started eating itself. You know, when the Metallica song says, chop your breakfast on a mirror, master, come crawling faster. And I think that's what that song is about. So my life really wasn't my own. My life belonged to drugs and alcohol at that point. And one day, after many times of trying to do the program, trying to do everything I could and not being able to do it, I woke up in incomprehensible demoralization one more time. I urinated on myself on a daily basis, waking up, coming out of blackouts, and I would pull the drawer out instinctually, like knowing that I needed some booze and hoping that I'd left some in the bottle from the night before. And then sometimes I would hold the drawer open, and a bottle, a fifth of vodka would come out with a little bit in the bottle, and then like a whole nother empty one would clink up, and I'd be like, whoa. I don't know how many days I was out. I don't know what happened. I don't know if I hurt anybody. It was a blur. I was completely powerless. I don't remember any of it, except when those bottles clinked. I remember that. And then I remember finally being so done, so sick and tired of being sick and tired, that one last time, one more time, you know what I mean? One last time I hit my knees with the blood and the tears and the snot, and I shoved my face deep in the carpet. When I was 9, when that stuff went down in my life, I shoved my face deep into the cushions of a couch. And for the first time, I wished I was anybody but me. I prayed to God to take my life. I was upset about God and the devil and the world. And I said, I didn't ask to be here. You're killing these animals. This little small possum had recently died, and it was my job to bury the small animals with the people in the neighborhood because I was like going to be a priest. You know, when I was 9, I knew all of the Catholic Church's sayings, and I could cite it. I'd verbatim when I was like a 7-year-old. I would like speak the sermon all the way through. I was going to be a priest, but then this one possum died, and I don't know, made a little cross with a red, white, and blue ribbon on it, and I was just tearing up in the backyard all alone. I remember looking up through the trees. I could still see the green of the tree contrasted with the blue of the sky. And I just cursed God. And I looked down and I cursed the devil and I said, I didn't want anything to do with both of you guys. I don't want anything to do with this. You know, so I mean, that feeling of not knowing why I'm here, what this is all for, I couldn't handle it. And I think that's why when I first got booze, when I first found drugs, and when I first found alcohol, I got that feeling of, hey, I finally fit in. It totally makes sense now. I think that's a big part of why it worked for me, because it took away that feeling, that oppressive pain that I couldn't do anything about. And it's hard to describe that type of pain and loneliness to somebody who hasn't gone there, but it's incomprehensible. It's just, it's a fact. It happens. Back up to where I finally, at my bottom of drinking and using, when my life was completely gone, I had no hopes. I had missed auditions to be in bands. I got fired from jobs, and I had nothing. I had no more friends. I had burned out my friends from my drug use and my alcoholism, and it was nothing but pain and desolation and desperation. So I stuck my face down into the carpet with the blood, snot, and the tears, and I said the first honest prayer from deep in my guts, and I said, help me. And immediately I immediately felt an overwhelming urge to stand up and go over to my desk. I followed the urge, I stood up, you know what I mean, wiped the snot off my face, and I reached my hand into a pile of trash, and I watched my hand come back out with a business card that said Jeffrey Wilson. From Edwards and Wilson Entertainment. And that was the number. I had met Jeff Wilson through an intervention that my mom staged. Before this, I was trying to get $20 for some weed. I told her it was for gas, and she had said, I'll help you out if you come to dinner with us. And I said, fine, whatever. You know, went to dinner. I'm sitting through dinner trying to get my $20 for some weed. And this guy, Jeff Wilson, is sitting there chawing on a steak and carving it and just talking about how the best thing about his life was that he was sober. Like, that was the greatest thing about his life. And I was just sitting there, and it was like, even though I had nothing in my life going, I was powerless and suicidal every day, I felt sorry for him. I was like, what kind of life is that? Who brags about not drinking? Oh my God, you poor bastard. Come on, give me my $20. But outside, he was smoking a cigarette with me after the dinner, and he gave me a card. He said, give me a call if you ever get serious about not drinking. It was that card that I pulled out. And I didn't call him immediately. I went around and I called my mom on the phone. That would be my last phone call to my mom. I called her, and by then, Al-Anon had gotten a hold of her. Jeff had taught her what to do. And I said, Mom, I'm really serious this time. I'm going to stop. I need some help. I just need some money and some time and just some clothes or whatever. So can you help me out? And she said verbatim, I'll never forget it. She said, call me back when you're 30 days clean and sober. Until then, I'm not your mother anymore. Click. I had lost my mother. It takes real strength to do that. And she was a strong woman. So I had this card in my hand. I had no other options. It was off myself again, or try to off myself again, which wasn't working, and or call Jeff. And I called Jeff and I said, "Hey, it's me, Chris. I met you at the dinner." He said, "Yeah, how are you doing?" And I was like, "I want to quit drinking and using drugs, and I can't stop by myself, and I need help. And I'll do whatever you tell me, because I don't want to die." And he said, "Where are you right now?" I was like, "I'm at the house." And he said, "Okay, here's what we're going to do." And immediately, I don't need to get into the details of what he told me to do, but he immediately had solutions. He immediately had next actions for me to take. He immediately gave me exactly what to do, and I did it. I stayed sober that first night. I didn't pick up a drink or a drug. I remember peeing on my weed, and a fair amount of weed in my trash bag. I just peed on it. I was like, "You want that weed? Go ahead and smoke that piss." And he was yelling at myself all, "I'm sober, I'm going to be sober," you know. And yeah. The problem is, I had so much drugs and alcohol in my system for so long that I had been medicating my mental illness with drugs and alcohol, and I had gone into somewhat of a psychosis, which, I mean, I can get into that later with my life, but for the intents and purposes of why I'm telling this story, which is a story of my recovery, I had opened my parts of my brain to the spirit world. There was communication. Now, whether, see, that's a part of me that, like, part of me wants to just tell you that the spirit world exists. But yeah, I was in the spirit world. But the problem was, too much drugs and alcohol makes you ineffective, so you can't really deal with the spirit world appropriately. You know, the messages were coming from the radio, and God and the devil were speaking to me. It was like a tug of war. I felt that I was in a tug of war between good and evil, and that they were tearing for my soul, one direction, the other direction. The second day of my recovery, I was in no shape to be driving, but I was in the shower and I was leaned down. I sat down in the shower and I was crying again. I looked down at my toe and I saw hair on my toe, and I thought to myself, "We're just monkeys, man. We're primal. We're animals. I can feel the blood in my body. I'm flesh. I am primal." You know, and I was so sick. I was in this world, but unprepared, you know, to deal with that level of quantum physics, I don't know how you call it, whatever. The fact was, I was in my shower, and I was looking at my toe and the hair on my body thinking, "I'm an ape," you know? And I got up, I got dressed, and it was the 25th of March. It was just bad. I had trouble dealing with my grandmother's death, and it was kind of like that possum that had died before. I had a problem with God. Big problem with God, that he took my grandmother, that he did this, that he let people die, he let sick people be sick, he just, you know, all this problems with God. And then I went into this, like I said, the psychosis on my third day of sobriety. It was the 25th, I think. Yeah. The second day was the whole, "I'm an ape," you know. I listened to the radio talk about rock steady and Foreigner's Hot-Blooded, Check It and See, and all of these things coming through. And it was the 25th of March of 1992, and I got in my truck and I went down to the safe store, Safe Stop or something, and I got a soda, and I looked on the counter and it said "Last Chance to Redeem, 25th. And I was like, "Oh no, I need to go to the AA meeting." And I got in my truck and I had my little recovery chip on my keychain, and I was driving my truck, and like, I would start swerving, but I grabbed that keychain and all of a sudden I could stay in the lane. So I was like, all right, this is working. I forgot to tell you the second day, Jeff Wilson drove 3 hours out from LA traffic to come see me at a Bob's Big Boy. And, you know, he said, "Meet me down at the Bob's Big Boy." And so I walked down there, met him there, and he bought me pancakes, and he started pouring all kinds of syrup on it, because you know you need sugar when you first get sober. Alcohol is basically sugar, and lots of the withdrawal gets curbed by candy bars and sugar. When you're new, brand new to sobriety, it really helps you a lot. And he poured a bunch of syrup on his pancakes, and he said, "Wow!" He goes. Then he proceeded to scare the hell out of me about AA alcoholism or whatever, and all the people that had died because of this disease, and that I was guaranteed to die and suffer if I didn't find a way to get sober. There was jails, institutions, and death. That's all that awaited me, and that was my only option, was to either get sober or die. It scared the hell out of me, you know. And he told me what to do. I had to go to a meeting and not drink or use no matter what. And that was the goal. So it was a third day of my sobriety. I got dressed and I went out and I went to the store and it said last chance to redeem. And it was the 25th of March in 1992. And I was driving towards a meeting in my truck holding the keychain in Riverside, California. And I saw a city bus up in front of me. And I had been so tired. My soul was tired. I just wanted to die. And then I thought to myself, okay, well, I need to go really fast and I'll go through the bus and God will make this miracle happen. And then I'll go to the AA meeting if this miracle happens and testify that that miracles happen. And you should get sober because look at me, I'm sober, blah, blah, blah. Miracles, believe in miracles. If God doesn't do the miracle, then I will hit the bus and die. And that's what I want anyway. If I die, I'll meet God and I'll be able to go, why'd you kill my grandmother? I floored my truck towards the bus. The truck was going about 75 miles an hour and the bus was stopped still. I hit the bus. The bed was folded, all four tires were flat, the engine went up into the seat. I ruptured both of my intestines. Internal organs were ruptured and I was on the ground. The seatbelt was torn. And I remember being on the ground, looking up at a cop and a fireman and just like saying, what? And just like knowing that like this incredible amount of pain, I was like in shock. I was on my back on the street. And this fireman was saying, what's your name? And I said, Chris. And he said, oh, who's your dad? I was like, Keith. And he said, okay, who's your mother? I was like, oh. And I thought about my mom, what she was going to think if she found out I hit a bus and killed myself. And that split second that I stopped talking to think about my mother and what she was going to think about my suicide, I couldn't talk anymore. And my eyes closed and I couldn't see anymore, but I could hear this guy. And he was like, stay with me, Chris. And it got dark and cold and I got small. And he said, stay with me, Chris. And it was like, I could swim. I was swimming back up and all of a sudden I could hear him better. Chris, stay with me. And just like, but I was so cold and I was so tired and I was so hopeless and I just wanted to die. I didn't want to be here. There was a part of me that just couldn't comprehend any of it. My whole life, I'd never understood why we're here. And I was shown what I believe to be an abyss. And that I believe that if you truly don't want to be with a higher power, that you have free will. And it was horrifying. And then I remember just blacking out. I mean, looking back and thinking about this story of my life is I blacked out. And I mean, just that was it. I lost consciousness. And then the next thing I know, I was on my back and I could hear. And I was on a helicopter. And I was out of my body. And I could see, I could tell what the lights looked like on the hills below. I could see electricity, and through that electricity and that energy, I could see what the hills looked like. I saw the cars driving. I knew and could see that there was two guys up in front of the helicopter. There was one guy next to me. I'm not a pilot, but if I was, I could tell you exactly how high the helicopter was and how fast it was moving and in what direction it was moving. I could be anywhere on the planet with just one thought. I could feel what a blade of grass felt like in China if I wanted to. I could be a whale. I could just sense what it would be deep in the ocean or anything at all. I could be anywhere. I was a bright, shining, powerful, undescribable intelligence, power, invincible, beautiful love. And then I kind of remember laying on my back, just everything was numb, and something came from far away. Something came towards the helicopter, something that was sentient. I don't know whether it was Christ, my grandmother, or God. I don't know. But it was something that moved unto itself, sentient, intelligent, and it moved. And it came towards me. And,